thank you all for coming. It's such a pleasure to have Ronnie Greene at Politics and Prose tonight. He is currently an investigative reporter for the Associated Press. He spent many years at the Miami Herald before joining the Center for Public Integrity a few years ago, where he edited a Pulitzer Prize-winning investigative report about the systematic denial of benefits to coal miners afflicted with black lung disease. That was the center's first Pulitzer Prize. We were just discussing how many nonprofits and foundations have gotten Pulitzer Prizes, because obviously they're not media organizations. So it's really quite an extraordinary thing to see that happen, and it really speaks to the quality of both the reporting and editing and the importance of that story. This is not a surprise, however, for those of you who followed Ronnie's career. For many years, he's produced a range of other award-winning stories from documenting horrific working conditions of farmhands in Florida, to deaths in Florida group homes, to the too frequent crashes of cargo planes. And he's also written one previous book, Night Fire, Big Oil, Poison Air, and Margie Richards' Fight to Save Her Town. Tonight, he'll be talking about his new book. It's called Shots on the Bridge, Police Violence and Cover-Up in the Wake of Katrina. In it, he focuses on events that took place almost to the day, exactly 10 years ago, on an unimpressive bridge over the Industrial Canal in New Orleans. It was only days after Hurricane Katrina had wreaked havoc on the city and its residents, many of whom had lost their possessions, houses, loved ones, and hopes. And it was in this environment that local police, many of whom remained on duty to protect the public, also were confronted with their own fears about the chaos engulfing the city. These two realities collided in a spate of violence on September 4th, 2005, on the Danziger Bridge, and evolved into a decade-long narrative that still has yet to be fully resolved. And it's a narrative that has become all too depressingly familiar across our country. From Ferguson to Staten Island to Baltimore and beyond, the shootings of unarmed and unwitting black citizens by police officers whose actions and attitudes seem to represent a wholly different system of blue-on-black justice. I wish I could say, Ronnie, that your book was neither so timely nor so urgent, but alas, here we are in 2015 with those shots on the Danziger Bridge echoing more loudly than ever. So thank you for continuing to shed light on this really important story, continuing to expose the darker truths behind it, and we really appreciate your being here. Thank you so much, and thanks all of you for coming. Please join me in welcoming Ronnie Greene.
Welcome, and thank you, everyone, for coming out tonight. I really appreciate it. Sure. In talking about the book, I'll start sort of at the beginning, for me at least, which was several years after the events on the bridge. I was just in my newsroom in Washington at the Center for Public Integrity one afternoon in August of 2011 when I happened to see a wire story, Associated Press wire story, about the conviction of several officers in New Orleans. They had been convicted for shootings of residents on a small bridge in New Orleans after Katrina, and also in the cover-up. And there were a few things about this story that really literally made me stop in my tracks. I read about one of the victims was a 40-year-old man with the mental development of a 6-year-old who had been shot several times in the back and died. I read also that a teenage 17-year-old boy had also been shot and killed that morning, and that police had covered up their actions. And for some reason, my instant thought was, if I could, to sort of stop time and figure out, how did these residents, how did the police officers get there that day? How were they brought together that morning, Sunday, September 4th, 2005, through nature and fate? How did they get there that morning? That was my first curiosity. And I also felt, when I read that first story, I and my instincts told me this is a book. I knew that this was a book that I really wanted to write. So as I peeled back some of the layers and started looking into those basic questions, how did the residents and the officers get there that day, I learned a few things. There were essentially two families on the bridge this morning. One of them is the Madison family, two brothers, Lance and Ronald Madison. And they were in town because the Madison family is a very long established, very well-respected family in New Orleans. 10 children were born to the parents. The whole family planned to flee New Orleans with Katrina coming, but Ronald, the 40-year-old, he didn't want to leave his family dogs behind. So Ronald stayed back, and his older brother, his protector, Lance Madison, a one-time NFL football player, would stay back with Ronald. So that's how the Madison brothers were in New Orleans at that time. The other family is the Bartholomew family. There was a group of six on the bridge that morning, that Sunday morning. And the reason they were in town is Susan Bartholomew, the head of the family, she gathered everyone in her family in her apartment on a second floor. And there were 10 or 11 people in her apartment, but only one van. And Susan said, if we all can't go together, we're all going to stay. So these were such human reasons why these two families were here to stay. And then I also wanted to figure out, in looking into this, you know, how did these two families meet at the small bridge that few people have ever heard of, the Danziger Bridge, 0.7 miles long. So I tried to place what happened to bring them there that morning. I'll tell you a little bit about that. The Madison brothers, they had tried to ride out the storm in Lance's apartment, second two-story condo. They, of course, floodwaters chased them to the roof, where Lance and Ronald were on the roof with the dogs. Ronald started crying. Lance comforted him. They waved and screamed for a helicopter that never came. So the brothers went 2 miles from Lance's apartment to another brother's office. One of their brothers is a dentist. He, at one point in time, was the head of the National Dental Association. His office is right at the foot of the Danziger Bridge. You can step outside and literally throw a rock and you hit it. So they took 5 hours one day to swim through the torment and torrents of Katrina to get to the brothers' dental office, which is where they were living. And this Sunday morning, Sunday, September 4th, 2005, they were trying to get to the family home where they both grew up, where Ronald still lived. It was 2 miles away. They couldn't get there. So this morning, they were walking back. They were depressed. They were beaten. They were beaten down by the misery of Katrina a week later. They were walking back to go back to the dental office. As far as the Bartholomew family, where they were and how they got there, they had also been chased from their apartment by the storm. They also broke the top of the house to go to the roof and waved for a helicopter that never came. They settled ultimately at a decrepit hotel room also off the Danziger Bridge. And this morning, the Sunday morning, there were a group of six from this family. Susan, the mother, who had said, we're going to all stay together, her husband, their two oldest children, their nephew, Jose, and his good friend, J.D. Brissett, the 17-year-old. They were walking from their motel room to go to a Winn-Dixie to get medical supplies for Susan's mom, who was very sick, get cleaning supplies. So these were literally two families just trying to survive the hurricane. They were guilty of nothing more than trying to survive the hurricane. I also wanted to learn as much as I could about the officers who ultimately raced the bridge that morning and whose gunfire caused such trauma and such misery. One of those officers is named Robert Falcone. And looking into his backstory, his fiancée was 9 months pregnant with Katrina coming. And conceivably, he could have gone to his bosses and said, my fiance is giving birth in 2 days. Do you mind if I stay with her? He didn't do that. He decided to report for duty. And Falcone had, before this day, Falcone had never fired his weapon while on duty in New Orleans. And the families and the police officers were both trapped. They both, in many ways, were hostages to the hurricane. Falcone and the partner got a hotel room, the last room available at the Comfort Inn Suites. He looked out his window and saw his car get submerged by the floodwaters. His gun was dunked in water and wouldn't fire. He was in many ways a hostage to the Katrina storm, as were the residents. Ultimately, Falcone was rescued by officers and went to a command center that was 3 miles away from the Danziger Bridge. And it was a crazy time for police. A couple of days before this Sunday, one of their fellow officers was patting down looters, was shot in the head. Police started taking to traveling the city streets with their own high-power weapons. One of the officers involved in the incident I'm going to talk about, every morning that he went out to patrol the streets, he had his 30-inch AK-47, his personal weapon, in the front seat, wedged in the front seat between his seats as he went out to patrol. There was also a profound lack of leadership by the city. The officers were on their own. As one supervisor later said, there were officers who really needed counseling. They needed counseling to get through this. But instead of counseling, they were given high-powered rifles and sent back into duty. And this is sort of the scene and the setting. So this morning, as the two families were walking over the bridge, literally crossing paths without speaking, the police get a call. It's a call, a 108 call, officer under distress. And there's no question these officers who raced into this truck, which I'll describe in a second, thought they were going into a gunfight. They were all very well aware of what happened to their colleague a couple of days earlier. They expected a war. As they said, it was us versus them. It was a really profoundly challenging time for everyone after Katrina. So the time was so crazy, not only did officers get around and use their own personal weaponry, they weren't driving police cruisers. They were driving any truck they could commandeer. And this morning they were driving a budget rental truck. There's two officers in front, there's nine in the back. They're racing on the same road, racing to the bridge, responding to what they think is going to be a gunfight. They get to the bridge, and before the truck even stops, the driver leans out the window with a handgun. He's steering with one hand and shooting with the other. And the two families on the bridge, the Bartholomew and Madison families, they are stunned by this. They start to hurtle over a concrete barrier. They start to go for cover. The Bartholomew family is at one end of the bridge. The Madison brothers are a little bit farther along the bridge, higher up, when the shooting started. And the shooting didn't stop. The officers didn't ask any questions. They just fired and fired and fired. And by the time they were done, two residents were killed. Ronald Madison, the 40-year-old, was killed, shot seven times in the back. And James Prissett, the 17-year-old teenager with the family, was killed as well. Four other residents were maimed in really a horrific scene. Susan Bartholomew, the mother, she had her arm shot off. As the bullets were coming, her 17-year-old daughter lay atop her, tried to protect her, and bullets kept coming. I'm going to read a couple of passages from the book. This first passage really is set after the shooting stopped. Other officers came and responded to the scene. And this is the perspective of an officer who was not involved in the shooting, but who came shortly after the shooting on the bridge. His name is Taj McGee. McGee stepped from the bus and witnessed the remnants of a massacre. He saw Holmes, blood pouring from his mouth, trying to breathe. He saw JJ, motionless, blood-soaked. Nearby, he spotted a woman on the ground. She was attempting to crawl. She was riddled with bullets. On the other side of the bridge, he made his way near Ronald Madison, slumped over, the back of his white shirt turned red. He was pretty much on his butt, leaning forward, slumped over. Madison was dead. Instantly, the images the officer took in didn't add up. When he stepped into the street, McGee was careful to check for bullet holes in the truck, but found none. Walking atop the bridge, he saw dozens of shell casings, but recognized all as coming from police weapons. He saw no guns near Holmes, none near JJ, none near the Bartholomews, and none near Ronald Madison. It didn't make sense. He began scouring every inch of the bridge, desperate to find evidence that the victims had fired first or carried weapons themselves. He couldn't fathom the other possibility racing through his mind. He kept scouring the bridge from one end to the other, and then began walking down the grassy area under the Danziger Bridge. Nothing. He passed by another officer and shared his findings. Good thing you're not working for a lawyer, the cop told him. McGee got back into the bus and drove away from the Danziger Bridge, trying to put the puzzle out of his mind. It wasn't his investigation. It wasn't his role to question the shooters. He returned to other duties. I didn't ask anybody anything, he said. I didn't want to know. An old adage entered his mind. Ask me no questions and I'll tell you no lies. At this time, other witnesses started to come to the scene. One of them was a troubleshooter at a hotel that was right nearby where Ronald was shot. And he happened to be that morning taking pictures of the hotel for insurance purposes. This troubleshooter had two cameras. He had one in his hands and he had one in his pocket. And when he turned out with the camera in his hands, police officer rushed up to him, took the camera and stomped it on the ground. Two or three hours after the gunfire had quelled, friendly and troubleshooter Robert Rickman walked back outside. Ronald Madison's body remained on the pavement. No officers were around, the lifeless figure left unguarded. Rickman pulled camera two from his pocket and began taking pictures. He snapped photos of the 40-year-old man lying before him and of shell casings around the body. No one from NOPD asked him a question that morning, but Rickman kept the photographs. They might be important one day, he thought. And the photographs and all the other evidence was important because the police that morning instantly launched into a cover-up. Before all the victims were wheeled to the emergency room for treatment, the four victims who were facing life or death injuries, the police on the bridge talked about planting a gun. In the next coming days and weeks and months, the police created the fiction. They charged Lance Madison, the protector of Ronald. They charged Lance Madison with attempted murder, said he tried to shoot the officers first. They planted a gun. that one of the sergeants retrieved from his garage. And they called it a ham sandwich. It went into evidence. And they also just truly created a fiction out of whole cloth. One day, one of the supervisors, when he was writing a report to justify the shooting, said, "Give me a name." One of his colleagues just blurted out Lakeisha. So in the police report, Lakeisha Smith was listed as a witness who swore that the Madison brothers were armed, who swore that the other families were armed. It was a fiction. And the police went to great lengths to keep this fiction in place. The police story that began to emerge in black and white was more like an airbrushed Hollywood screenplay than an official recounting of that devastating morning. Filled with jolts of creativity, invented witness and evidence, phony names and fabricated facts. And like a screenplay going up the line of the studio for notes, the police reports went up the line of supervisors, who sent back comments, wrote through confusing passages, and strove to craft a Hollywood ending. At times, like the director and stars hovering over the film director's final cut, the whole NOPD crew stood together over a computer terminal, looking to strike just the right key. In their story, the police were unquestioned heroes, standing tall amid nature's fury to save their city from looters and shooters. The department had no hunger for an independent review. What it wanted more than anything was to keep the massacre out of the public view and to cast the officers on the bridge as public servants, doing their job during the torturous days after Katrina. It took a fair amount of sweat and occasional bickering to strike the right tone. Let me veer off the narrative just for one second and a little side note. One of the things in researching the moments on the bridge, researching the people drawn together that Sunday morning, the residents and the officers, and researching the history of civil rights cases in New Orleans, past, present, and seemingly future, I feel like I could never stop learning. There was so much to learn about that morning, so much to learn about this department, so much to absorb about Katrina. There were almost so many horrors that you couldn't keep track. Let me give you just one example. As I had mentioned, there were 8 family members on the bridge that morning, one group of 6 and one group of 2. And in my mind, I had a really good sense of where the 7, what happened to 7 of the victims. Remember, Ronald was killed. His brother Lance was arrested. And then the other family, the Bartholomews, Susan had her arm shot off. Her daughter Alicia lay atop her to protect her and had bullets shoot into her and had to get life-saving surgery. Their nephew, Jose Holmes, was left for dead. A paramedic said, don't work on him. He's too far gone. And Jose whispered, "Don't give up on me." They saved his life. And Susan's husband, big Leonard Bartholomew, had been shot in the head. Then there was little Leonard Bartholomew, the 8th person on that bridge. And when I last left him in my mind researching this, he had met a bystander that day who looked after him. And I sort of lost track of him. And I thought, let me route back and figure out what happened to Leonard Bartholomew. One thing I'll add about Leonard is he was not hit that day. He and Lance were not hit. But Leonard, when the police stormed out of this budget truck and started shooting, he ran down the embankment of the small bridge. An officer leaned out the truck and fired 2 shots at his back and missed. So I'm going to route back to Leonard and tell you what I found. For nearly 2 weeks, Susan had no idea where her son, little Leonard, was, and she woke up each morning jolted by worry. After Morel Johnson looked out for the boy that Sunday morning, little Leonard met a woman who was driving people out of New Orleans in buses. The woman, Carla, heard a story and took him to her home in Baton Rouge for 1.5 weeks. She and her boyfriend cared for him and put a notice on the internet about a missing child. In Texas, his uncle Jerome saw the notice and came to get him. Jerome drove Leonard Bartholomew IV directly to the hospital. His mom was in a wheelchair, her right arm shot off. His sister Alicia was in a hospital bed, unable to walk. Cousin Jose, his close pal, lay in his own hospital bed, unable to talk, with a metal plate in his jaw. Surrounded by loss, the teenager was suddenly engulfed by guilt. Why wasn't he shot too? Looking toward Cousin Jose, he started crying. "I'm sorry," Leonard told him. "I should have been shot too. It isn't right that I got off, but everyone else has to go through all this pain. And I'm just walking around, I'm fine. I don't have to worry about injuries, it just isn't right." Jose looked at his cousin, lifted an arm, and gave a thumbs up. "You didn't do anything wrong," he was saying. "None of us deserve this." And for me, I mean, I really focused on that moment very late in my research, but it showed me there were so many horrors and so much trauma that it was almost hard to keep track. And that moment now stays with me. This 14-year-old boy saying, "I should have been shot too." It's such a profound moment. None of us deserve this, is what Jose was telling him. What's interesting about this case is, despite the horrors I've described, it really took these residents, these families, having to push for justice. It was a year after the shooting that the families filed lawsuits in New Orleans that alleged a whole different narrative. And initially, sometime after that, the local DA filed charges against some of the police officers involved. The officers were paraded as heroes. When they walked their first court appearance, they literally were paraded as heroes. And the case had some twists in the local system, so much so that the Madison family in particular, led by the brother who's a dentist, didn't trust the local DA to right the wrong. While there was a case pending, the DA's case was pending, the Madison family and others pressed for the federal Department of Justice to come in. They didn't trust the local agency to do the right. And they were right. A couple of years after the case charges were filed, a judge dismissed the charges. And then the Department of Justice came in, led by the Civil Rights Division here in Washington, a very aggressive federal prosecutor who has spent her career working on civil rights cases, worked with a rookie FBI agent who started his career as a mechanical engineer but decided to go into the FBI. Then they teamed up with agents and prosecutors down in New Orleans, and they took a much deeper review of the events on the bridge. They knocked on doors that had never been knocked on before. All the witnesses who may have seen something that morning were never questioned by the NOPD. They were now being questioned. The U.S. government, the DOJ, shut down the Danziger Bridge 4 years after these shootings, the search for evidence. Didn't find anything, but it sent a message that they were looking. And they started knocking on doors of the officers. And they started confronting supervisors with evidence that, hey, you guys were crafting a fiction. And after many, many years, a couple of key supervisors pleaded guilty. They crossed that blue line. And I want to read a short passage. Remember I told you that when that budget truck was racing to the bridge, the guy who was driving, the same guy who had an AK-47, his own personal AK-47, he leaned out the window and fired warning shots. His bullets apparently didn't hit anyone, but he fired warning shots and scattered the families. His name is Michael Hunter. Hunter had been wrestling with demons from that morning in September 2005. After officers were first charged in state court, he was assigned desk duty doing paperwork while the criminal case coursed through the court system. Another officer, Anthony Villavasso, worked alongside him. Each day, officers would come by the office, shaking their hands and ripping into the DA for prosecuting police for doing their job. One day, Hunter had enough. As Villavasso and fellow officers celebrated the police actions that morning, Hunter rose from his desk and stormed to the bathroom. Villavasso followed him. "What's wrong?" Villavasso asked. Standing inside the men's room, Hunter turned to the officer. "There's nothing cool about being indicted. We're not heroes." Michael Hunter never wanted to climb the police ladder to stardom. He wanted to be a cop, nothing more. The officer had sent his four children, from his infant to his eight-year-old, out of town and reported to work during Katrina. His radio was promptly ruined by saltwater. His cell phone, stuck in his pocket as he patrolled the streets, was ruined too. Each day he headed out for duty heavily armed. When the 108 call came, he's the one who raced the driver's seat. He wasn't an opportunistic guy or an ass-kisser, said his lawyer. He was a quiet, solemn sort of guy, a go out there and do the police work kind of guy. Now Hunter faced the most wrenching choice of his life. From the start, he had gone along with the cover-up. He looked himself in the mirror and admitted he hadn't had the courage to tell the truth. But now, with FBI agents knocking on his door unannounced and word spreading that supervisors had already begun cooperating, everything had changed. The truth had gotten out, he said. It was just a matter of time. And in some ways, a huge asterisk, it was just a matter of time. Ultimately, the DOJ case led to a successful prosecution and led to that very story that I had first read in August of 2011. And that, in some ways, was the only, if you can call it joyous, the only moment where the victim families, had some sense of relief. The officers were convicted of nearly every count. And as the surviving family stepped out into the bright New Orleans sun that August day, they were greeted by supporters, by throngs, who hugged them. And tears flowed down from JJ's mom, Sherelle Johnson, and Lance Madison, who testified about what happened that morning. He read a note from top of FedEx, piece of paper. He worked at FedEx and talked about the horrors that he had went through and the relief he finally felt. But it really wasn't relief. It was a temporary relief, because a couple of years later, the judge overseeing the case vacated the jury verdict and directed for a new trial on issues that have nothing to do with the events of September 4, 2005, have nothing to do at all with that. And here we are 10 years later, it's been 10 years, and for the victim families who lost a son and a brother, who lost an arm, who suffered life disfiguring injuries, and who were completely innocent, completely unarmed, the justice remains unresolved for them. And so as I was looking into this book starting in 2011, of course, so many cases of note started to develop across the country over 2014 and 2015. I again stopped in my tracks when I saw the pictures of Walter Scott tumbling to the ground in North Charleston, South Carolina, the Freddie Gray case in Baltimore, Eric Garner case in Staten Island. All those cases were profound tragedies. So many of them started with the most innocuous of moments, someone being pulled over for not having, you know, the tags on their car, and ultimately someone dies. Those are all really painful cases, but in retracing and thinking about the Danziger case, I really can't think of another case that was as severe a case of a civil rights abuse. When you look at both the trauma and the bloodshed atop that small bridge, and then you look at the extent of the cover-up that was put in place. It's really a significant case study, and I think it has some lessons that I'm glad to talk about during the Q&A. I'm going to read just one last very short passage, and then I'll be happy to take any questions you guys have. As those events played out, I kept thinking back to the two families hunted on the Danziger Bridge on September 4, 2005, following a police distress call that had nothing to do with these eight residents, each of them black and unarmed. 10 years later, justice for these families remained an open question, a development both sobering and telling. I kept returning in my mind to an insight Marc Morial, the former New Orleans mayor and current president of the National Urban League, shared as I interviewed him about the Danziger case in the summer of 2014. In order to convict a police officer, you don't have to convict him beyond a reasonable doubt, Morial said. You have to convict him beyond all doubt. I also recalled the words of Edwin Shorty, the lawyer for the Bartholomew family, as the press for legal closure remained in limbo. How much justice do you expect when you've been shot at by a police officer? In Louisiana, the families of the victims continue to pray. Sherelle Johnson, JJ's mom, wakes up each morning to a home without her son, 17-year-old killed on the bridge. It's never going to go away, Sherelle told me recently. I loved him to death. I love the ground he walked on. I wonder what he would be. I wonder what if. My whole life, she said, is spent wondering. Thank you.
If you have a question and could make your way to the mic, I'm sure you're not all this shy, really.
Good evening. Thank you for your presentation. I had occasion to confront a police officer when I was a cab driver, and I had called in a break-in where I was asked to pick somebody up, and they said, wait for the police to arrive. Cabs are kind of easy to see. They're yellow and black, lights all over them, and I was leaning against a cab. And he showed up, immediately jumped out with a shotgun, and leveled it at me. And I just looked at him like he was crazy, and he finally agreed with me, I guess, and he put it down. But there's some mentality there that I'm very concerned about, and it seems to keep popping up. I wonder if you looked into that at all.
Well, one thing I really want to make clear about this is what the officers did in that bridge that morning was completely wrong in every possible way. They shot first, didn't ask any questions. They covered it up, and at the end of that cover-up were real good families. But I really tried to put this shooting in context of what they were going through, what the department was going through. Their fellow officer had been shot in the head. There was a complete leadership vacuum atop the New Orleans police. I talked to a former officer who went back to search for bodies 10 days afterwards, and he said 10 days in, no one was in charge. The fact that the officers could go around, carry their own AK-47s to patrol the streets speaks to the craziness of the times. So I really tried to understand that. I think there's no doubt there was real palpable fear in that budget truck. The officers thought they were going into a really chaotic, terrible situation, but they weren't. These were good families. And again, ultimately they shot first, didn't ask questions, and they covered up. So I thought it was important to put it in context of the times.
I'm curious about why the police arrived guns blazing at this situation. Who called them? What did that person or persons think was happening? Why did the police get the situation so wrong and react in such a totally unnecessarily violent way?
Sure, that's a good question. So this morning, and there's so many threads of this story, it could be five books, to be honest with you. This morning, other officers were going the I-10, which runs parallel to the small Danziger Bridge, the I-10 in New Orleans. They were towing boats en route to rescuing people. As they come down the I-10, there's a man dressed in a sheriff's office outfit who says, they're shooting at me. And the lead officer who was in this car, her name is Jennifer Dupre, she heard him, and she saw a couple of guys with guns nearby. So she called in. The situation was so chaotic. They were connecting through handheld radios, people talking over each other. She called in 108, which means officer under distress. She never said officer down, officer shot. But at that banquet hall where the officers were staged their command post, they all assumed that. They all assumed, I think, that there was an officer down. Just a couple of days earlier, one of their brethren, Kevin Thomas, was shot in the head. So they race out to the bridge. The irony in this, there were apparently some people in the area earlier that day with guns. But the guy who flagged down the officer, he wasn't an officer at all. He was a convicted felon who was dressed like a sheriff's deputy.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
In listening to the story, you know, I think about the cover-up that took place and that the story that they weaved to cover up what they had done was based on the idea that they were, you know, shot at first, that they were under attack or something of that nature. And I think in considering people, it's almost cliche, police officers have a dangerous job. Everybody accepts that is true, but it seems to me that the police don't accept it as true. Because if you know you're doing a dangerous job, you accept the danger in doing it. If you're a bike messenger, you have a dangerous job weaving through traffic. But you can't pull out a gun as soon as someone creeps out into the intersection and you feel like you're threatened and they're about to hit you. Right. You either got to get hit or get out of the way, and you know you accept that danger as part of your job. And in instances such as these, police officers are able to get away with these murders because they felt threatened. They were anxious. They were nervous. They thought someone had a gun. They thought it looked like a gun, so they can just shoot first and ask questions later. And even in this instance, if someone did have a gun on that bridge, if there was something going on, it would have been justified for them to go on this maniacal shooting, bloodlust, shooting out of a car or whatever, shooting people's arms off, shooting people in the back, even when they're scattering, you just continue to shoot, and right. Reload and shoot some more. So that's, you know, my, you know, issue. And I'd like you to kind of respond to this sure. idea of giving them a pass just because there is danger or there might be danger.
Yeah, I don't think anyone should give the officers a pass for what happened that morning. But I think you do hit an important theme. One thing I noticed is when the officers were writing their cover-up, when they were creating their fiction, you didn't have any sense at all that they were looking over their shoulder, that the mayor or the bosses at the police department were going to make sure they had everything right. They were operating in many ways with impunity. And I think what that showed me was the importance at a very local level that the mayor, that the police chief play. When Mark Morial was mayor, he had appointed an outsider from Washington to lead the department who wasn't friends with officers or respected them, but he was a disciplinarian, and the FBI was embedded in the office there. During Katrina, the mayor was Ray Nagin, who had never held office before, and there was no sense from these officers at all that the police chief was going to tell them what they were doing was wrong. And that showed to me the significance of the importance and the significance of having strong leadership that tells these officers, you can't get away with writing these fictions when there were human beings at the other end of this.
Yeah. I think this is a very important issue and remains extremely important. Before I came to the United States, I'm from the Caribbean. I studied in the Netherlands, you know. And I was confronted with this when I was a student at USC, where somehow it became known that I was a lawyer, I studied law, and people would bring me in from Watts and stuff like that to talk to them about police violence, right? And I honestly, I'm not at all claiming Holland is perfect or something like that. Obviously not, okay? But the stories that I heard were absolutely flabbergasting and shocking, right? Kids walking down, being thrown against the wall, being called all type of names, et cetera, et cetera. So what I would like you to maybe do a little bit more here is to place this whole story in a larger context. I mean, you begin in 2005. Obviously, this outcome, I mean, what we have there is basically Jim Crow racism run rampant to a certain extent, and I cannot say if these policemen had problems. But you have there a way of policing in the South, and I've been to New Orleans, right, based on a long, long history. And also, basically, what happened in New Orleans was a failed state, right? New Orleans became a failed state, a failed locality. So when you have all of this complexity of a history of basically extremely racist policing, going back to slavery and going back to the setting up of the police departments and the role the police departments have to play to a large extent, right? Protecting the majority against minority people. Then you fundamentally create a very, very volatile situation that in any type of uncertainty, and especially with breakdown of rule, can become completely untenable. And I suppose maybe you want to talk about that a little bit on all these different levels.
Sure. Yeah, that's one of the things when I couldn't, you know, I stopped learning. There was so much to learn about this. When I started looking into New Orleans police, there had been really troubling cases going back decades of officers violating the civil rights of residents. And what really was striking for me was even after the events on the bridge and after Katrina, the Department of Justice Civil Rights Division did a report that looked at incidents after this, and there was a striking disparity in the treatment of minority residents in New Orleans by the police department. So it's a profound issue that is still being addressed and dealt with today. And I tried to put that in a larger context in the book.
Hi, Ronnie.
Hi, Melody.
Great reading.
Thank you.
I was wondering, you made reference to recent events in the last year or so, but I haven't seen this event on the Danziger Bridge referenced at all in these reports. Have we already forgotten? Has anyone but the victims' families remembered this?
Yeah, that's a really good question. Something I thought about a great deal as those other stories, each of them tragic, played out. And my best guess is, for one, there were so many horrors after Katrina, and a lot of the horrors were proven to be untrue. They were falsehoods about the depth of what was happening in the Superdome. But there were so many stories coming out of Katrina and so much true misery after that storm. I used to live in South Florida, lived through hurricanes, lived through Andrew, but never through Katrina. It was profound. That this case initially, I think, was just one of so many horrors. And the other thing is, the truth about this case rolled out very slowly. It took a year before the families filed a lawsuit that said, hey, there's a different story here. But then there was some, you know, there was a question, well, who's telling the truth there? And that, and the next case rolled out over 2 years. Then it was 2 years later before the DOJ brought a case. So because it was piecemeal, I'm not justifying that. I think this, as I mentioned, I really think this is one of the more significant cases of civil rights abuse in the last, in our lifetimes, to be honest with you. But it didn't play out because of those factors. Other questions?
Hi, Ronnie.
Hey, Melissa.
Thanks so much for your reading and for bringing this issue to our attention once again. I have a very simple question. I'm interested in the number of officers you are able to interview and also how you gained their trust on such a difficult issue.
Well, that was one of the challenging things in this case, particularly after the judge overturned the verdict and vacated the trial. I put in requests for all the officers, and to a person, through their lawyers and their families, they would not talk about this case because the case may come back. I certainly talked to other officers, talked to a former officer who spent 17 years in the force and now is a lawyer for police, to get a sense of the time of Katrina. I also went to the sentencing of these officers, where multitudes of police officers stood up and spoke. None of them excused the deaths on the bridge, but so many of the officers said, at this crazy, chaotic time, that could have been me. That was a theme that played out. I also read the transcript of the trial, pulled tons and tons of records on all the officers in all the various cases. So I tried very hard to get at their perspective through that and talk to their lawyers at length as well.
I still don't have a hard time understanding the timeline. What is Katrina hits, and then sometime later there's shots on the bridge. Could you just explain when is this occurring relative to that?
Yeah, 6 days later. It was the first Sunday after Katrina, so Sunday, September 4th, 5 or 6 days after landfall in New Orleans. It was the first Sunday. It was a beautiful morning that morning, apparently, and so everyone went out. And then the chronology, here we are 10 years later. It's still active. If you want me to walk through a little bit.
If Katrina's a week earlier,
Monday.
Why are buildings still being flooded? You said people were... I mean, wasn't the decision to go, no-go, a week earlier than the families?
Well, these families had stayed in New Orleans, yes, and they were just trying to survive, and they couldn't. Some of them couldn't get back to their homes.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, Ronnie.
Hey, Catherine.
I think the U.S. Attorney, Jim Letton, was that, seemed to be a good guy from everything I've read and know about him, but could you talk a little bit about vacating the verdict? Wasn't it his office and some...
Yeah, what happened, just to give a real quick overview, is that there had been a couple of prosecutors, one who was non-involved in this case, who, whenever there were local stories in the Times-Picayune about police wrongdoing, a couple of prosecutors would weigh in with anonymous comments. And a lawyer in an unrelated case found out that one of them was a prosecutor in the U.S. Attorney's Office. And he was weighing in on so many cases, and he was ripping the police left and right. The defense for the officers argued, their main argument was they felt that these anonymous online comments were part of a larger Department of Justice conspiracy to essentially convict the officers before they went to trial. And they thought it prejudiced their clients. It seemed like a real long shot. Hadn't those anonymous comments, it's not clear a juror ever saw them, and there's no sense that it had anything to do with the justice that played out. But the judge in this case vacated the ruling largely because of those anonymous comments.
Have they rescheduled the trial?
No. That's still being played out.
Hi. Thank you. I'm wondering if you made any efforts to put Katrina in context with a sort of long history of flooding in New Orleans and efforts by white authorities to use sort of these states of emergency in order to perpetuate extra legal violence against blacks, going back to the huge floodings in the early 20th century and the 19th century as well.
There's been some excellent reporting on that topic by the Times-Picayune, which is a terrific local newspaper. I mean, I'd looked into the flooding to the extent that it played out in that time and the impact it had on the psyche of everyone, residents and officers. But beyond that, it really wasn't something I looked at beyond those issues sort of front and center.
I'm going to jump in while this gentleman gets to the microphone. Is there any evidence of anything being done to improve the New Orleans Police Department as a result of all of this?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So years after Katrina, the DOJ Department of Justice came out with a really detailed report that looked at police practices and protocol in New Orleans, and they found systematic breakdowns, and they found that targets of police fire and targets of police physical altercations were disproportionately black residents. And so that led to a consent decree between the Department of Justice and the city that called for all sorts of new protocols and all sorts of new training that was supposed to right the ship. But after the city signed it, the city tried to back out of it for other reasons. A judge ultimately confirmed the consent decree, but it's a work in progress. After the police chief who was in for Katrina, he resigned shortly after that. They went through several police chiefs. They called them superintendents. There was a reform-minded superintendent who was in charge. And I thought, well, this is great, because when I was researching the book, his name is Ronal Serpas. On his website, he talked about these cases are a black eye for the department. We have a 65-point plan to improve. I tried very hard to interview him to talk about these things. And coincidentally, as I was going to one of my trips to New Orleans, he quit. He resigned the force, unrelated to my inquiries, but I promise, unrelated to my inquiries. But he resigned, so there's a new chief coming in. So it's, who knows? Who knows? I know that there's not really been a steadying of the ship when there should be in New Orleans Police Department.
What's really funny is she took two-thirds of my question. It points to a larger question that this is certainly not the first consent decree that the Justice Department has pursued against numerous police departments. You can look at Seattle. They're now obviously investigating Ferguson. Is there a larger story or failing here as a result of how many police departments are under review or consent decrees as a result of this kind of activity.
You know, that does seem to be a trend in several cities across the country. I think Cleveland may be going through one as well, if I'm not mistaken. But that goes back to my point earlier. I think the importance of the local leadership, setting the right tone, not saying to police officers, we don't like you, respecting police officers, the job is demanding and challenging, it's life or death, but letting the officers know, if you veer off course, you're going to pay the price. I don't think that was the case during Katrina at all, with tragic consequences. I think that strong leadership can make a huge difference so that you wouldn't need consent decrees.
Ronnie, can I ask you one other question, sort of getting back to this gentleman's point about the police just being held, not being held accountable and sort of operating with impunity. Can you envision a situation in which it seems to me that a really well-trained police force that didn't have a history of systemic injustice towards a huge part of their local population should have been able to respond even to the chaotic circumstances without the kind of behavior that was exhibited in this incident?
Yeah, that's a good point as well. And that's one of the points that Mark Morial, the former mayor, said to me. He said, you know, when a department, not every officer is corrupt, obviously, but when a department has corrupt practices, those instincts just kick in. And this cover-up just kicked in. They were talking about planting a gun before the bodies were taken away to the hospital. That's how quickly this came about. So if you have an office, if you have a department where you know that's not going to be accepted, maybe it won't kick in so quickly.
Well, and also the initial acts of violence that there was a reflexive kicking in of not asking questions, as you said and as you said.
It was beyond chaotic. You know, as I mentioned, the driver of the car leaned out the window and fired warning shots. There were 9 officers in the cargo area in back who could see behind but not in front of them, so they hear these gunshots, and it just went crazy from there with real consequences for the residents.
Any more questions? Can you run up to the mic? And, sir, you can go back up.
Sorry to do 2 questions, but to follow up on that, in your research, did you find, like, in this sort of systemic, the system of corruption, did you find other cases that you thought might have been covered up?
Well, there...
Regulate, please.
Yeah, no, there were other cases, including one really striking case right about this time involving a man named Henry Glover, who was shot in the back and then burned, set afire after Katrina. So there were so many cases to keep track of.
Yeah, my question is similar to that. I know that there were the bridges were blocked, and like after the storm was over, residents who were trying to leave the city couldn't even leave the city because there were police and militia guards on other bridges as well. And I was wondering if there were any other shootings, or you know, maybe not to that extreme, but anything like that.
Yeah, I mean they're. Clearly there were other shootings, and I mentioned one earlier that involved the police officer as a victim, and that really intensified the bond between the officers, where this feeling, I talked to a police officer a couple of weeks ago who said, in normal times, police officers can very quickly turn into an us versus them, because your job can be draining and challenging, or dealing with really difficult situations all the time. And if you put the context of Katrina in that, it's quantified many, many times beyond that. It was truly us versus them, particularly after one of their fellow officers had been shot. And that was a culture that it can lead to these types of abuses.
Even in those instances, as you mentioned, if the policies and the mindset of the police were as it should be, you would become, you know, more, just like when you see people get shot down, and then you know communities might start to, you know, bubble up, and you have people come out and say, "No, we got to calm down. This is a time for peace." You don't see that with the, you know, in this instance, nobody was coming out saying, "Hey, all right, tensions are high. One of our officers got shot. We don't need y'all going all crazy because you're afraid. You got to calm down. Remember your training, and just stick to what you're supposed to do, and try to calm the situation down." Instead of going out there and making it worse, shooting people's arms off.
That's exactly what they needed to hear. And they didn't hear enough after Katrina, there's no question. And again, there's no question. There's no reason for these officers to fire a single shot at these two families. They were unarmed. They were just trying to survive. That speaks to the culture that goes back decades and also the time. Another thing I'll mention about the officers is, while several officers, 5 in all, later crossed the blue line and agreed to cooperate, they didn't do that voluntarily. And that's one of the things the families would set at their sentencing. If just one of the officers on the bridge or one of the supervisors in those early days stood up and said, this was a shoot gone horribly wrong. We thought these were the people we were going after, but they weren't. Lance Madison, who lost his brother, would have not have spent 25 days behind bars, standing with his back to the wall, afraid someone's going to try to kill him. If just one officer had stood up and said the truth, that would have made a profound difference.
I have a question based on a fictional account, which actually sounds very much realistic, which is Tremé, the David Simon piece, and particularly the series that really deals with police and these cases. In fact, this case, and in fact, I think the Henry Glover case.
Yes.
And does that seem to you to ring true, the way they describe it there?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a fan of David Simon's work, going back to The Wire and Homicide in Baltimore and Tremé. Yeah, he focused really heavily on the Glover case. He alluded to the Danziger case several times, but he seemed to do, a thorough job of capturing the culture of New Orleans, the great city that it is, and the craziness that also occurs in that city.
Well, I think we have sadly come to the end of a wonderful event. Thank you so much for coming. Thanks, all of you. And again, books are available up front. Ronnie will be happy to sign up here, and we really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. Thank you.